Hey, what's up everyone? NeoCyther here, getting back to Yu-Gi-Oh! Legacy of the Duelist. And it is time to fight the next duel in the series here, the Ultimate Great Moth. Before we start though, I do need to clarify something that I was confused about with the last video. Also, I just realized my volume was turned up on my TV too loud, so I apologize if it came through the mic twice. But I need to clarify exactly how Heart of the Underdog was working in that last fight, because I was confused a bit too as to when it was and was not drawing more cards when multiple effects activated. So because of how chains work in Yu-Gi-Oh!, if you have multiple Heart of the Underdogs going off at once, you'll draw the one card for each, but because you can't add things to a chain as resolving, you only activate them again if the last card you draw in the chain is a normal monster. So if I'm understanding this correctly, let's say you have three Heart of the Underdogs on the field. And for your draw phase, you draw a normal monster. You reveal it, and all three cards will have their effects added to a chain at once. So I'm just going to call them Heart of the Underdog 1, 2, and 3. And let's say that's all that happens. No other effects get added. Now the chain starts to resolve. Let's say Heart of the Underdog number 3, the last one added. Let's say you draw a spell card. Number two, you draw a trap card. And then number one, the first one that got added, you draw a normal monster. If I'm understanding this correctly, all three Hearts of the Underdogs will go off again and get added to a new chain, because everything has resolved. And then you go through the process again and draw through more cards. However, let's say that the first card you draw, so the effect of Heart of the Underdogs number three, the last one that got added, let's say that is a normal monster. I can't remember if the game actually asked me if I wanted to activate the effects or not, but because I'm in the process of resolving a chain, and you can't add anything to a chain until it's resolved, nothing really happens. So no effects get added. So even if the second and third cards that I draw for the other two Heart of the Underdogs are normal monster, or sorry, are like a trap or a spell, I can't draw anything else even though I did draw a normal monster. So long story short, because of how chains work, it all depends on what the last card you draw is for the chain. If it's a normal monster, the chain can start again. If it's not, then it won't. That makes more sense once I read up about that. It also means you can probably chain that and make a pretty darn good Exodia deck for this game, but that's probably for another time. Anyways, you'll notice above the Ultimate Great Moth next to the Heart of the Cards, we have the exclamation point there. That's because we unlocked the reverse duel. I'm not going to go through the reverse duels on this, because essentially, to my knowledge, you're just a flip-flopping spot, so I'd be playing Kaiba using his deck if I wished. So I'm just going to go through the main stories, and next up is the Ultimate Great Moth, in which we fight some, or duel some little nerd. After his win against Seto Kaiba, Yugi was puzzled to receive a package from Maximilian Pegasus, the creator of Duel Monsters. Inside the box was a videotape. Yugi inserted the tape into the VCR, and Pegasus' face popped up on the TV screen. So, this is kind of a weird point in the second episode. Basically, Pegasus wants to duel Yugi. He basically freezes time through the VCR, takes Yugi to the Shadow Realm briefly, and, well, things get, for Yu-Gi-Oh! Standards, things get weird. And you basically get a bit of a description about how shadow games work. You'll also notice a couple things. First, I don't think I brought this up last time, but Yugi's name in some of these conversations where the Millennium Puzzle is activated is Yami, or Yami Yugi. I can't remember what the name Yami actually stands for, but you don't actually learn like the true nature of Yugi for a while. You also notice that Pegasus almost always keeps one eye covered. Yugi looked down at the Millennium Puzzle that he wore around his neck. Thanks for that pointless narration, because you can't show Yugi actually looking down. And you learn about the 7 Millennium Items. Yugi has one of them with the puzzle. As the two duel, it seemed that Pegasus knew every move Yugi was going to make before he did. Despite this disadvantage, Yugi mustered all his skills and nearly won, but Yugi ran out of time when the time limit passed. I do believe that there was like a time limit to the game in the episode. It's been a while since I've actually watched the really early episodes, other than Kaiba getting blasted by Obelisk. That will never get old. And now we learn why Pegasus has been keeping one eye covered. Because he has the Millennium Eye. The power of the Millennium Eye lashed out and stole Grandpa's soul. Yugi could only watch in horror. And now Yugi goes back to Yugi. Yugi had no choice but to compete in Pegasus' Duelist Kingdom tournament so that he could get his grandfather's soul back. At Duelist Kingdom, each duelist was given 2 star chips which they could wager against other duelists on the island. Whoever earned 10 star chips gained entry into the tournament finals where they would compete for the 3 million grand prize and the chance to duel Pegasus himself. For his first duel, Yugi faced off against the conniving Weevil Underwood, a duelist with whom he had a bit of history. While riding the boat to Duelist Kingdom, Weevil took Yugi's precious Exodia cards and threw them into the ocean. So when Yugi spied Weevil on the island, he chased after him into the woods. And now you also know why I wanted to be Kaiba with Exodia last game. Because we no longer have the Exodia cards. In fact, I believe that is probably the only time, probably for a while, before we have a chance to use Exodia again. At least through the story decks. So, yep. It is time to fight Weevil. And Weevil, a couple of the names of the characters also kind of give away what kind of deck they use. Weevil uses insects. As usual, I'm going to go second. Let's see what Weevil wants to do in the first round. Set a monster on defense mode. And place one card face down. Really? It's going... Wow. Not a lot of monster options right off. But this does give me Graceful Charity, Rude Kaiser, Spellbinding Circle, Tariki, or Tarike, however you want to pronounce it. Doesn't have the greatest attack, but I do want to see what that monster is. So we'll summon it. And then 2 Mirror Forces. Mirror Force is a pretty powerful trap card. When an opponent's monster declares an attack, you destroy all your opponent's attack position monsters. So I'm going to go ahead and set one of them. And I will set Spellbinding Circle. I probably should have done Graceful Charity instead of using Tariqe now that I think about it. But again, I kind of want to see what this is. I'm probably going to regret it. Yep, big insect. But at the very least, it shows what monster he has. The problem is, though, I'm kind of vulnerable. Laser Cannon Armor. Oh, boy. An insect-type monster equipped with this card increases the attack and defense by 300 points. Mm-hmm. I'm going to hit yes just because I want to take a look at this. Okay, I'm good. We're going to switch into, Cure Needle. Nope, I'm good. Nope. Nope. Not yet. Now, yes. Is he is targeting me? No, not Spellbinding Circle. I'm going to activate Mirror Force. Oh wait, Cocoon of Evolution. Tribute one insect monster from either field. Equip with an equip card, and if you do, special summon one insect monster from your deck, ignoring its summoning conditions. During your main phase, you may banish this card from your graveyard, and then target one insect monster in your graveyard, shuffle into your deck, draw one card. Okay, let me make sure I understand what he's doing. Tribute one insect monster from either field, equipped with an equip card, which he has one. If you do, special summon one insect monster from your deck, ignoring its summoning conditions. Okay. During your main phase, you may banish this card from your graveyard, and target one insect monster in your graveyard, shuffle into your deck, draw one card. I think I know what this is going to do. That goes off. He sacrifices that. It's destroyed via Mirror Force. Cocoon of Evolution goes off. Perfect Ultimate Great Moth goes back to his deck. I'll go back and he... Am I the only one confused by a good chunk of that? Alright, so we're going to go and set Mirror Force. Let's go and summon Feral Imp. We'll go to the battle phase. And there's something else I forgot to mention about changing positions. If a monster attacked that turn, they cannot change positions. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and go to the main phase. And let's go and play Graceful Charity. Really? Do I have my extra deck? Scare of Sanjin. Kaiser. What's in here? Oh, Guy the Dragon Champion. Well, we might learn about fusion. Depends on how long it takes us to get there. Of course he has that. Protect defensive on... Oh boy. I'm actually not going to activate the effect of a card. I'm good for now. Second polymerization, really. Okay, so You're going to go ahead and go ahead and summon Curse of Dragon. I'm going to go to the battle phase. I know he can summon the perfectly ultimate Great Moth. That's kind of why I'm holding off on the other Mirror Force. I've also got Spellbinding Circle if worse comes to worse. He didn't do anything. What was that? That was Horn of the Unicorn. To equip monster gains. I cannot see. 700, I think? Yeah, the equipped monster gains 700 attack and defense when this monster is sent from the field to the graveyard. Return it to the top of the deck. We're just going to go ahead and do that. Because again, I've got Mirror Force and I've got Spellbinding Circle for defense. So with that, we're going to go ahead and go through the battle phase and just straight up attack Weevil. So if he can't do anything his next turn, this is going to be a very short video. Does he have nothing? Wow, I can't even get Dark Magician out. Darn. We're just going to go straight to battle phase, because if he can't do anything against this... Wow! That went a lot quicker than I thought it was going to. I would seriously have loved to have known what is in his hand. Because he had absolutely nothing. Yeah, your moth is unbeatable. The same one that you summoned, and then it got destroyed by Mirror Force. Alright, so now we have the Harpy Lady campaign duel unlocked. Reverse duel, the Ultimate Great Moth. We get the Weevil Avatar unlocked. The Moth Evolution deck. New booster pack for My Valentine. Signature card award, Cocoon of Evolution. Petite Moth. Graceful Charity. And 1516 duel points. Let's see, 100 for the win. 20 for the number of turns. 4 for using spells, 2 for traps, or trap, 4 for tribute summons, 10 for unused special summons. Those, I believe, are probably referring to the 2 fusion cards I had. 0 for maximum attack, I still don't know what that means. 29 for difference in life points. So I have a theory about that, for difference in life points. Let's see, because if you take 29 and multiply it by 3, or by 300, you get 7,700, which is how many I had left. So I'm thinking, you get 300 points, I'm sorry, you get 3 points, no, you get 1 point, for every 300 points in difference in life total. Maximum damage reflected. Win by inflicting battle damage only 10. And I'm guessing that's if... I don't know if that's referring to me summoning Perfect Ultimate Great Moth somehow, or him. I think... I don't think... Yeah, in the original duel... Well, yeah, it would have had to have been me, because... Technically... Weevil did summon Perfectly Ultimate Great Moth, I believe. It just got wiped out immediately by Mirror Force. So I want to go back now that we have a couple booster packs. I didn't mean to keep going. Crap. Yes. I didn't mean to keep going. Oh, as you can see, next we're not even playing as Yugi. So I'm going to go back. So we're going to go to the card shop real quick and check it out. Okay, I see. So you can buy booster packs now with your duel points. And we have the different, depending on what game, you have different packs. So I'm not sure what, like, the 34 out of 932, 11 out of 942, like, what totals those represent. Like, maybe total cards, period, or number of cards in the set, I don't know. And just kind of check out deck edit real quick here. We got basic structure deck. And then we can do a bunch of whatever decks we want. Let's kind of look at the basic structure deck real quick. This was a pretty short video. Looking at my recording time right now, yeah, we just passed 21 minutes. This was a short duel. I think I've talked more than the duel. Let's kind of take a look at what's in my structure deck here. Oh, we have the Blazing Apache. Firing Pegasus, Garrochin, Gorgana, Great Angus, Nimken Dog, Dragon Dwelling in the Cave. I think this was the deck you used in the very first duel. It's got a decent amount of stuff in there. Wow, it's got a copycat. This card is summoned. Target one face-up monster your opponent controls. Does the card's attack and defense become equal to theirs? A couple things that I haven't had a chance to talk about yet. Flip card, or flip effects. When you place a flip effect monster face down, when it's flipped up either by you doing what's called a flip summon, which you can do as many flip summons as you wish. I just saw something in my trunk that I'm curious about now. Or if it's targeted in an attack, even if it's destroyed, it'll flip face up first, and that's when the flip effect goes off. So, like if I set Gale Lizard face down, either it's attacked or I flip summon it, I can target one monster my opponent controls and then return it to their hand. Liberty at last. Dust Tornadoes. There's some decent stuff in there. No, what I was surprised by. Was this. I don't know how, like, we have cards in our trunk. A lot of cards in our trunk that aren't from the original series. Okay, sword by. I mean, I always got swords. Card frame. So you have, like, monsters. Effect monsters. Pendulum monsters, but I don't know much about pendulum monsters. That, I believe, is Arc V or Vrains. No, I think that's Arc V, was when pendulum came into effect. Then you got spells, traps, synchro monsters, Xyz monsters. And then you got fusion monsters. I only got a couple fusion monsters. Yeah, so synchro monsters was 5Ds. Fusion monsters have been around since the beginning. Unfortunately, do not have my favorite fusion monster yet. So, I'll briefly explain fusion summoning for those who don't know. It's pretty much the same, or it's pretty basic. The basic way to fusion summon is you have to have polymerization in your hand, which you saw during the previous duel. I had two of them. And on a fusion monster. Let me actually get back down here real quick. You can see there, like, for Labyrinth Tank, it'll show Giga Tech Wolf plus Cannon Soldier. I have to have both those cards either in some combination of on the field or in my hand. They're sacrificed, tributed, whatever you want to call it, along with polymerization, and it allows me to pull this card from my extra deck and summon it to the field. Some of these have different effects, which can kind of make up for the fact that their attack may not be that great. Like, Parapsychroid only has 1600 attack and 1200 defense. It's a level 5. But all you need to summon it are two machine type monsters with the same name, and this card can attack your opponent directly. So for not the greatest of attacks for a fusion monster, it doesn't require two specific monsters, technically just two machine types of the same name, and it can attack the opponent directly. Again, evoking the age-old phrase, unless something says otherwise. So once we get closer to, I don't think they're going to come up, unless I make my own deck, they're not going to come up in any of the original series story decks. So I'll talk more about Synchro Summoning, Xyz Summoning, Pendulum Summoning, and so on, when we get to those series. Oops. And at some point I may go down through the cards I have and actually try to make my own deck. Which will probably go as good as you think. But my goal is to only use story decks for the campaign duels, just to kind of be like, okay, well, this is what they use in the anime, I'm going to use it myself. And also, I forgot to mention, I have won these first three duels. I'm not expecting to win every duel the first time. So that being said, I won't be showing when I lose, but if need, what I'm going to start doing actually is start putting in the description of the videos, and I'll do this for the first couple as well, that you might have noticed this, I will put how many times I lost before I won on the video you're seeing. So yes, every video you see, I'm going to win the duel, because otherwise this might be a very long series come later on. After all, how many times do you ever see any of the main protagonists lose? With that though, I have rambled on long enough for this video. So I thank you guys for watching, and I shall see you next time when we play as another character fighting off against another character. New character.